Turn your Bibles, if you will, please, to Matthew chapter 9. We're going to talk this morning about the problem and solution for ministry. The problem and solution for ministry. I've bitten off a big chunk of scripture here, but I want to tell you I'm not going to do a word-by-word methodology at this time. I just want to take it and talk about ministry to you because it's on my heart. And I think just by way of introduction, there are two things that really informed me as I studied the text this week. The first is that I've been all wrapped up in preparing for the short overview that I'm going to be doing and have started in Principles of Evangelism on Wednesday evenings, which I'm teaching to the men in the men's Bible study. And whenever I consider the incredible privilege that we have as individuals, as people, sinners saved by grace, to share the gospel of how people can have eternal life to others, I just think it's amazing. It's a great privilege. And I get fired up to where it's difficult for me to contain myself. So that went into this gospel. I'm kind of preparing you, right? Secondly, it was kind of like a last-minute punch that came to me and put an exclamation on all that I had already worked on during the preparation for the sermon. Friday night, in the middle of the night, in a small village in Colombia, while people slept in their homes to the sound of rain coming down on their corrugated tin roofs, a devastating mudslide coursed through the town and took over 250 lives. They're all sleeping. Not one of those destroyed in that tragedy went to sleep that night, Friday evening, knowing that they would be going into eternity. They all perished, unsuspecting, swiftly, and without warning. One villager who was able to escape said, "They were all fast asleep when the torrent of mud hit their neighborhoods, and the sludge was moving so fast there was not even time for them to run for their lives, and they perished." How many of those people went into Christless eternity Friday evening? I wonder those things when I read accounts like this. Without hope, without hearing the message of the gospel, there's a distinct urgency in the gospel message, people. And I'll be talking about that in the sermon today. The urgency is that there are people all around us that we're rubbing shoulders with every day. We don't know if they're going to be alive tomorrow. And they don't either. And if they've not heard the gospel, and that's becoming more and more a distinct possibility in our culture, and we have the gospel and we're not sharing that gospel with them, we need to be gripped by the urgency of the gospel message. So with that, look at verse 35 of chapter 9 in Matthew's gospel, and we'll continue our life of Christ. Jesus was going through all the cities and villages in Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every kind of disease and every kind of sickness. And seeing the people, he felt compassion for them because they were distressed and dispirited like sheep without a shepherd. Well, the very first thing that I want to talk about is the problem. The problem. The people were like sheep without a shepherd. That has not changed. We're not looking at the lost sheep of Israel, but we're looking at people around us today that are like sheep without a shepherd. And I'd just like to bow our heads just for a moment and ask God's blessing and help. Father God, as we come to your word this morning, we contemplate the problem and solution for ministry. Lord, we would pray that you would open up these scriptures to our minds and our hearts today in a new and a fresh way, and that we would see what Jesus' words meant at the time that he preached them and taught them, and that we would take them over into our lives today and apply them to our lives, that we'd get the primary meaning of the text, but that we would also take the principles out of the text and apply them to our own lives, Lord. I would pray as your messenger this morning that you would use me in the things that I've studied this week to bring home these truths according to your will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, the very first thing that we see in these verses is just kind of a short overview of what Jesus was doing, a summary, if you will, that he is going through all the cities and villages, and he was doing that in Galilee. We've been looking at Jesus Christ's Galilean ministry. At that time, the cities were larger groupings of people, and they were usually walled. They had walls around the cities, and it would be a protection for them. And then villages would be unwalled. I think of today where we talk about incorporated and unincorporated. You know, when you're driving through Wisconsin or northern Minnesota and you buzz through a little town and there's like a gas station and a tavern, of course a tavern, okay? And as you come into the town, it says unincorporated. You know, sometimes they have the population, 132 people, you know, unincorporated. Well, those were the villages. And at the time that Jesus was doing his Galilean ministry, a village would contain 15,000 people, but it was small. It wasn't real large. And there were approximately 200 cities and villages in Galilee. Jesus' Galilean ministry spanned a period of about 18 months. And during those 18 months, he would go from village to village and city to city and preach the gospel and teach. His ministry was comprised of three elements, we're told. In Matthew 9:35, it says that he taught in the synagogues, he proclaimed and preached the gospel, and he healed every kind of disease and sickness. Now, no effective ministry will ever be all talk. No matter what you see on Google and YouTube and the internet. Ministry, true ministry, is always talk with action. There's got to be action and behavior that follows the talk. It can't be all action with no talk. There needs to be teaching. It's both the lips and the life that need to be engaged for true ministry to take place. Jesus not only taught, and he not only preached, but he also went from village to village and city to city, and he healed. He laid hands on people and talked to people and ministered to their needs. He extended his hand to the needy and desperate people that he met, and he healed them. Such a man was moved with compassion for the needs that he saw around them. Look at verse 36 with me. Seeing the people, he felt compassion for them. He felt compassion for them. First, I want you to see that he saw the people. Seems simple, right? But a lot of times, ministers, especially in this day and age, they're not even looking at people. They're looking at the almighty dollar sign. How much can they make off of this gig that they got going? Jesus looked and saw the people. Most are so self-absorbed, they don't see others. And we can take it to our own hearts as well today, people. When you look at people, do you see people? Do you see them? I mean, here on church on Sunday morning, let's just get real, okay? Here at church on Sunday morning, we all look pretty good. You know? We all put on clean clothes and we come and we all put on a smile and everything's good. And you're talking to people and you just kind of pass by each other. Do we really see each other? Do we take a minute to talk to each other? I know we're a friendly church. And I'm not saying we're not, and we need to increase more and more in our friendliness and our love towards one another. But let's talk with each other. Let's find out where each other are at. It wouldn't be a bad thing to put your arm around somebody and pray for them if they're troubled or if they're struggling or if they're having a problem. Do we see people? Do we really see people? Well, Jesus wasn't self-absorbed. As he traveled throughout Galilee, he saw people, and everywhere he saw their plight, both physical and spiritual. He looked beyond himself to others. He saw them. Now, there's a certain thing that happens to ministers, okay? We can get so busy, we get dry. We get dry. It happens. And I had a seminary prof whom I loved dearly. He was a firebrand. And he'd talk about what he'd do when he'd get spiritually dry in his ministry. He'd leave his office or his study, and he'd go to a corner cafe in East L.A. And he'd get some coffee, and he'd just look at the people in the cafe. There'd be a rough-looking teen who snarled his order to the waitress and had an attitude written all over his face. And he'd think to himself as he sipped his coffee and looked at that teen, what made him so bitter? What was in that young man's life that made him as bitter? It just reeked of bitterness and anger. What had he faced in such a young life that it so soured him? And he'd ponder that. Or he'd look at the man sitting on a stool at the counter, scruffy, ill-fitting clothes, and obviously drunk, trying to talk to the server into giving him a cup of coffee for free. And he'd think to himself, that man is somebody's son. Very possibly that man is somebody's father. He has a mother. And he has a father. What happened in his life to drive him to this point where he's reached that level? Or he'd see a cute little girl, cute as could be, yet with a father treating her roughly, grabbing her by the arm, plopping her down in the seat. Now stay there and shut up. And he'd tell the story just looking at that little girl, and his heart would begin to soften as he considered what it must have been like to live in her home, if that's the way he treated her in public. And his eyes would grow moist, and he'd long to be able to be in her life, to be able to protect her, to be able to talk to her father. He wanted to be in all their lives, and he'd remember his calling again afresh, and why he was a pastor all over again, and he'd take all of that compassion, and he'd go back to church and go into his study and pray for each one of his flock and prepare his message. That's what I mean when I say, do we see people? You know, do you see people around you? Do I see you? Pray for me that I do. Pray for me that I'll catch myself if I get dry spiritually and go to my cafe, wherever that may be. All I need to do is drive up and down Payne Avenue, believe me, or go downtown St. Paul, or out to Woodbury. Right? People are everywhere. And the vast majority of them do not know Jesus Christ. Well, that professor who was a true shepherd renewed his heart, softened it when it became hard in the ministry by going out and intentionally putting himself in place to see people. Maybe that's what Jesus was doing when he went from village to village to village, just looking at the people and ministering to them. I don't know. But that's what he did in his Galilean ministry. Secondly, he felt compassion. When he did see them, he saw their spiritual needs and their physical needs, and he felt compassion for them. This establishes the humanity of Christ. He had emotion. He wept. He got tired. He got hungry. He became thirsty. 100% God, 100% man. He experienced these emotions, even as we do. But compassion is an emotion that's born out of love. Splagnitzomai is the word, or splagna, the noun. And it refers to the bowels. Okay? And in Jesus' day, it was the way that they referred to deep, deep emotion. We have similar metaphors that we use. We get news that just levels us, and we say it was like a gut punch to express what we feel. Or young love and the breakup. They're having a broken heart. Believe me, it's for real. They feel like their heart is broken. Do you remember? So the people in Jesus' day, that compassion was their bowels. It was a visceral feeling when they felt love and compassion for someone and mercy. Except for a couple of instances in the Gospels, in the parables, every time this word is used, it's used only of the Lord. Very interesting. He displayed compassion for the world's pain when he saw the sick in Matthew 14:14. When he looked at the blind and wanted to heal them, Matthew 20:34. And those afflicted by demonic presence in their lives, Mark 9:22. He did everything to alleviate their pain. And he wore himself out doing this. He felt compassion as he observed the heart-wrenching sorrow of the widow of Nain. I can't wait to preach that message. Following after her son, her only son, she didn't have anybody else. Her husband had died. And now her son was gone. And they're on their way to bury him, coming out of the town as he and his entourage were going in. Don't let me go. I'll just start preaching on it. I love the story. The compassion that Christ had for her. It's in Luke 7:13, following. And he was moved with pity when he witnessed the tired and hungry crowds who had been following him and listening to his teaching. And that's when he fed the 5,000. Because they had no bread and they hadn't eaten. Matthew 15:32. And his compassion was moved by the loneliness of the lepers. He doesn't heal just one or two lepers. All the way through his ministry, he's healing lepers. I've worked with lepers. Half of our village were lepers. And they're needy, needy, needy people. They're ostracized by many. They're afraid to get close to them. And they're lonely. They're physically hurting. And they're shut out from human interaction, often hopeless. And yet he reached out and he healed so many lepers. In each instance, the same word is translated compassion that our text uses here. It shows us that Jesus felt deeply and his pity towards those people in trouble moved him toward them in love. Love moves toward others, not away from others. Sin separates. Love brings together and makes us move towards one another. It shows us how deep Jesus felt towards these people that he saw and he had compassion upon. Thirdly, he saw that the people were distressed and dispirited. These words are choice and used very specifically. Distress, skullo, literally means to be harassed. In some places, it means to be flayed or skinned. And this is the way Jesus saw these people, and this is why he had compassion on them. They were literally flayed spiritually, left to die. It brought with it the idea, this word of being battered relentlessly. Just can't seem to get it. Every time they just start getting up, something knocks them down. And Jesus saw them distressed like that. They were like being in a little boat and the waves just keep coming and knocking it over until finally it's overcome and it sinks. And this is what Jesus saw when he looked at the people. And they were at a crossroads, but there weren't any signs. They didn't know which way to go, which way was up, we say, right? They're helpless and hopeless. And then on top of skullo is ripto, distressed and dispirited. Skullo ripto. This word means to be thrown down, indicates somebody who's downcast. You know, the people that you see in church that aren't smiling. In fact, they're doing just the opposite. Maybe at best they can do is just a straight across mouth, right? Kind of a grimace. Things are going hard for them. Put your arm around them. Let them know they're loved. Let them know you see them. That's what Jesus would do. It indicates somebody that's thrown down. It's used of a drunk who's laying prostrate in a stupor. Or it could refer to someone laid out dead. In fact, the Septuagint, the Greek translation of the Old Testament for Judges 4:22, it has Sisera lying dead with a tent peg in his temple. Lying dead is the word here. Ripto. Wow. These are graphic words. But they portray what people without Christ are like, and it portrays what Christ saw when he saw people without him, without hope, and what he did. Finally, the people were like sheep without a shepherd. That was his summary statement. They're like sheep without a shepherd. Beaten up, brutalized, harassed, helpless and hopeless, laying prostrate on the ground, and they had no protection, no guidance. It's a picture of people without Christ. Whether they're prepared to admit it or not, that's their state. And then just to kind of top it off, there were physical maladies that even enhanced their spiritual destitution. Some put a good face on things outwardly, but deep down in their hearts, they knew that they were in deep trouble. And that was what the people were like that Jesus saw in all the towns and villages, cities and villages of Galilee. Their religious leaders were primarily responsible for this. And Jesus tells them as much. Because they didn't lead, they didn't feed, and they didn't protect the people that were under their charge. They'd abandoned their post as true shepherds and fulfilled the Old Testament prophet's words. Listen to these strong words against shepherds that were false. Woe, shepherds of Israel, who have been feeding themselves. Should not the shepherds feed the flock? You eat fat and you clothe yourselves with wool and you slaughter the fat sheep without feeding the flock. Those who are sickly, you've not strengthened, and the diseased you have not helped, and the brokenhearted you have not bound up, and the scattered you have not brought back, nor have you sought for the lost. But with force and with severity you have dominated them. I can think of people like this in the ministry, and you see them on TV all over the place. Is that not a picture of religious leaders of Jesus' day? The Pharisees and the scribes? Is it not a picture of many leaders today who are raking in? I had one man say, go look at the parking lot. It's filled with very, very rundown cars. And the pastor has got a couple of jets. Drives around in a very, very nice car. And yet everybody that comes to his church and gives and gives and gives and gives more so that they can receive blessings, so maybe they can get some wealth, are destitute and they're poor. And this man just keeps on raking it in from them, whatever man that might be. Boy, I would not want to be standing before Jesus in that state. They put heavy loads on the shoulders of people, but they were unwilling to remove the burdens of the people themselves, and they didn't even lift a little finger to help them, Matthew 23:4. That was the religious leaders of Jesus' day. So you couple the dispirited and distressed people that Jesus saw, and you add the fact that these were Jewish people he's talking about, and their leaders weren't doing anything for them. That's just even worse. To all the distressed and dispirited people, Jesus called out what? Come unto me. Come unto me. No wonder people flocked to him. No wonder the multitudes listened to him. You who are weary and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. It's the same today. His call is the same today. Don't ignore it if you hear him. You see, that's the problem. And what we've just listened to, what you want to see in true ministers, ministers who minister, is you want to see them feeding the flock. You want to see them strengthening the sick, healing the hurting ones, binding up the brokenhearted ones, bringing back those who have gone astray and seeking the lost. That's what you want in a minister. And that's what you should be. Today, my goal in the sermon is to take the ministers off the pedestal and talk to all of you. Okay? Because we're all supposed to be ministers. That's one of the things that Luther brought back. It's called the priesthood of believers. We're all supposed to be ministers. Maybe I shouldn't be up here. Maybe I should just be standing there. I don't know. Luther's day, they were like way up there. I couldn't do it here. Pulpit roof's not high enough for my pulpit. They would walk and climb up into the pulpit and it would be over the people. I think it was kind of a throwback to the Roman Catholic hierarchy of the day, you know. But I want, one of my goals is to take the minister and say, your ministers, our job as leaders in this church is to equip you for the work of ministry. It's not just a spectator sport, guys. I'm not just here to put on this act for you to all watch and then go home and talk about it and how bad I did. And I'm sure there's times I do bad. I'm sure there is. Don't talk about it, please. It's bad enough I did it. Let it die and pray for me. But that's the problem. They were like sheep without a shepherd. So what's the solution? What's the solution? Well, workers for the harvest. Look at verse 37. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Therefore, beseech the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into his harvest." In such an economy of words, Jesus identified both the problem and the solution. The harvest is indeed ripe. Everywhere Jesus looked, he saw broken and needy people, sheep without a shepherd, and this is the harvest, and this is the problem. And what the solution was is, workers, we need people. Okay? I remember the leadership on the mission field, we'd have conferences and they'd say, well, so-and-so is not coming back from furlough. And they want us all to know that their hearts are with us, but we really would appreciate their bodies too. Because there was so much work to do, right? And we'd lose people and it would just be terrible. I feel that way every time somebody leaves the church. I need you all. We need you all. You need to be here. But you need to be rolling up your sleeves and working. There are people that needed to be brought to the fold of God, where the food is to eat, and shepherds that will feed them, and leaders that will lead them and guide them, and shepherds who will protect them. There's a need for workers and in care of those workers. Being a missionary, I've heard countless messages off these passages here. The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Pray the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into his harvest. And there is a need for people to bring the gospel to foreign lands. I don't want to take away from that. To places where the name of Jesus has never been spoken. But is that the context here? Is Jesus calling out for foreign laborers there? Go like this. He's not. He's not. And that word there, disciples. He said to his disciples, this is before he called them. He's talking about those who were learners, those who were sitting at his feet learning and listening to him in all the villages. He was talking to you, okay, as followers of Christ. Yes, I know in chapter 10 he calls out the 12 and names them, but they're just 12 out of a whole bunch of other ones that we can follow their tracks and so that we're not confused with these multitudes that followed him and were his disciples. There were many more than 12 that followed Jesus. And he's talking to them here. And I want to bring out seven things, okay? Seven characteristics that Jesus talked to the people about. And yes, his 12 disciples were part of it. But you know what we do? We take those 12 and we shovel everything over to them. Or we take pastors and missionaries and full-time Christian workers, shovel everything over to them, and then it's just a big show. And we watch them do the work. Bad. That's not the way church is. Read Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 16. Very clearly lays out, you guys are the worker bees. We're to train you and equip you to do the work of the ministry. And that's what we're trying to do. I want you to know the call was urgent. Jesus said, pray the Lord of the harvest, because the harvest is plentiful, but beseech the Lord of the harvest to send out workers. In another place, the sentiment is spoken by Jesus when he says, don't say there are still 4 months until harvest. No, lift up your eyes and look on the fields. They're white for harvest. There's an urgency to the call. That's the first point. The harvest is imminent. Listen, I want to tell you what. The harvest took place in Colombia on Friday night, and nobody knew it. The harvest is imminent. Jesus saw the people through the eyes of eternity. As sheep without a shepherd, distressed and dispirited. In a word, lost. They were lost. What do you think of when you think of the harvest? Okay. Pray the Lord of the harvest. What do you think of when you think of harvest? From this morning on, I want you to think of harvest as judgment. Judgment, people. That's what the word means here. And that's what lends urgency to the need. Jesus commanded them, therefore, beseech the Lord of the harvest to send out workers in his harvest. When we seriously pray for God to send out workers, believe me, if we're serious and sincere, our hearts will be tender and we will go into the harvest. What do I mean by judgment? Well, soon we're going to be studying the parables. And in one of those parables, there's a parable of the wheat and the tares, isn't there? And in that parable, the harvest is spoken of. Allow both to grow together, the wheat and the tares, until the harvest. And in the time of the harvest, I will say to the reapers, first gather up the tares and bind them in bundles and burn them up, but gather the wheat into my barn. The harvest has to do with judgment. Again, in Revelation, we read about the time at the end where Jesus is telling us, put in your sickle and reap because the hour to reap has come. Because the hour to reap has come because the harvest of the earth is ripe. And another angel came out of the temple, which is in heaven, and he also had a sharp sickle. And he was told, put in your sharp sickle and gather the clusters from the vines of the earth because the grapes are ripe. The harvest Jesus was thinking of in our text today has to do with the judgment. And that's what lends the urgency, because we don't know when somebody is going to be facing that, their last day. How do we know the people that we see around us at work are going to be there Monday when we leave Friday? For it is appointed to men to die once, and after this comes what? The judgment. It's harvest. I believe the Lord would have all of us telling others about the gospel all the time because there's urgency and we are the workers. Secondly, not only is the message urgent, but the messengers are equipped. You are equipped. If you are a believer, you're already equipped. Jesus gave his workers the authority that they needed to declare the message in chapter 10, verses 1 through 6. He tells them that he gave them power and authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal every kind of disease and every kind of sickness. Now, we don't have that same power to heal today that Jesus gave his men, but they had that power to authenticate that their ministry was the Lord's ministry. And once the canon was closed, told you I'm dispensational. Once the canon was closed, we have it all right here now. We don't need to authenticate our message by healing or by doing miracles or by speaking in tongues. All of those were authentications that the apostles that did those things in the first century were God's people. They affirmed in people's minds so they didn't have to wonder about them. But how have we been equipped? Because I said we're equipped too. Well, they were supposed to go to the lost sheep of Israel. We're supposed to go to the nations. How are we equipped? Well, Peter has told us that God has granted to us everything pertaining to life and godliness. Paul reminds us that our adequacy is not in ourselves to consider anything as coming from ourselves, but our adequacy is from God. Jesus said in the Great Commission, all power has been given unto me. Go therefore. Why therefore? Because he's got power, he's given it to us, and he tells us to go and make disciples of all nations. That's our mandate. Verses 5 and 6 talk about a focus. The 12 that Jesus was sending out, he sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Our focus is broader. It's the whole world. But how about just the east side of St. Paul? Or Plymouth? Or Brooklyn Park? Or Woodbury? Or Oakdale? Or wherever you're from? How about your company? How about your school? Go ahead, take it on. Have a focus. And preach the gospel. The equipping is present, and the need is still very, very huge. Thirdly, they were to give the message freely. I'll tell you, there's much to this. The message was simple and clear. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Listen, you could die tomorrow. Are you going to go to heaven? Do you know for sure that you're going to go to heaven? Right? The evangelistic question, if you were to die today and you were at the gates of heaven, what would you say if God asked you, why should I let you in, right? What a way to start a conversation. Go for it. How hard is that? How many classes do you need to learn that little phrase? I just gave it to you, right? If you were to die tonight and you were to go to heaven and God were to ask you, why should I let you into heaven, what would you say? There you go. Write it down if you want. I'll repeat it again. And pigeonhole every single person at work and ask them that question at the lunch table. Make it your goal for the next 6 months. Or at school. Why not? Are you a believer? You hold the hope of eternal life. You know it. You're going there. Are they all? And I mean, if they blow you off and think, wow, what a Jesus freak. Oh my gosh, he's weird. Or as I heard this morning, there's a big movement now on that Donald Trump is mental, okay? He's got mental issues, mental problems. And I turned to Mary and I said, that's what they're going to say about us. That's what's going to happen to us. They're going to trundle us off to get cured, man, because we are exclusive. We're holding forth the truth in a world that doesn't believe in absolute truth, and they're just going to trundle us off as mentally deficient people. Wow. Bring it on. I'll have time to read. Quiet time, you know? No cell phones. It's okay. Don't worry about what they're going to say. I'll talk about that in just a moment because people do say things. The worker received the message freely. You've received the gospel message freely. Freely give it out. The worker's worthy of his support. You know, this is for full-time workers, those that go into the ministry. Just be honest with you. The Lord will take care of your needs. I have been in ministry for over 40 years, people. And I have never really sought after salaries or type of money. When we were on the mission field, we lived by faith. That means we didn't tell people what we needed. We always had money. Now, granted, many of our other missionary friends drove motorcycles while Mary and I rode bicycles. The Lord was humbling us. Then I borrowed a motorcycle to take the kids on a youth trip, and somebody stole the motorcycle, and I ended up buying a motorcycle, and I didn't even own it. Right? Guess I needed a lot of humbling. But you know what? The Lord's always taken care of us. We've never been hungry. You ever been hungry? We've never been hungry. I live in a palace. Those of you that come to my house, we didn't hanker after that. That was a gift from God. I'm telling you the truth. And we were able to bring Mary's mom into that beautiful home. You know? Go figure. It's hard to explain that sometimes. I had one guy come to my home and say, "Can I ask you something personal, Steve?" I said, "Sure." He said, "How are you living in a house like this?" Well, there's lots of things to be done yet in the house, but it's way better than the hut that we had. But God takes care of his people, and he'll take care of you. You don't have to worry, people. Fourthly, it says they were to expect hardship. Verses 16 through 20. "Behold, I send you out as sheep in the midst of wolves, so be shrewd as serpents and innocent as doves. But beware of men, for they will hand you over to the courts and scourge you in the synagogues." Jesus didn't sugarcoat things. What a call to ministry. He was clear that they were going to face opposition and hardship as they obeyed his commands to proclaim the message. He gets very graphic with his language. They're going to be like sheep in the midst of wolves. Not a good word picture. I see wool flying and blood. Right? I'm sorry, that's what I'm calling you to. As believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, to give out the message of truth, you may lose your job over it. But would you rather be faithful to your Lord and Savior, who you're going to spend all eternity with, or to your employer, who's not paying you enough anyways, right? Honestly, speak out the truth. He advises that they need to be shrewd as serpents and harmless as doves. What? Serpents, like, that's the devil, right? Oh, come on, you've got to understand the scripture and context. Serpents in that day were considered to be very cautious, very smart, adept at any given situation. So in the same way, Paul admonished believers that we are to act with wisdom towards outsiders and make the most of every opportunity. That's all Jesus was saying. He's not saying you're supposed to be devilish. But that's what happens when you just take one word and do a word study. And you say, "Well, the serpent in the garden, now, he was kind of shrewd too, and he tempted Eve. I don't want to be like that." No, that's apples and oranges. You're not understanding the context. It is more than a warning of danger too. It provides an idea of where the message is to be proclaimed, okay? Did you get that? It's not that you're supposed to give this message that the kingdom of heaven is at hand. It's not for the confines and safety of our own gatherings. Okay? That's not out where the wolves are. You're to actually go in the midst of where it's needed most, out in the thick of it. And it's a given that in that context, you're going to suffer hardship. You will get blowback. But that's okay. And that's the whole point of this passage. He assures them of the Father's power and presence wherever they go for his name's sake. He's not going to let you down. Look at verse 19. "But when they hand you over, don't worry. Don't worry about it. Even if you were to be taken before a court of law because you're preaching the truth, don't worry about it." Why? Because you're doing what your Father would have you to do, and he is speaking through you, getting his message out. We are his hands and his feet. At least we're supposed to be. Fifthly, they were to expect loneliness and persecution, verses 21 through 23. "Brother will betray brother to death, and a father his child, and children will rise up against parents and cause them to be put to death." Oh my gosh, that's a horrible thing, but it happens. It happens. Today, much ministry is preceded by much thought and care as to the implications of locations and salary and longevity of service. But the ministry the Lord called his followers to is fraught with deprivation, especially of personal security and comfort. Believers who obeyed the Lord's injunction to bring the message out into the world would not only face pushback from outsiders and religious leaders and government officials, but Jesus warned them that their own families would reject them. How are we doing there? Are they all saved? Do they all understand the gospel message? Later in verse 36, he repeats the warning by saying, a man's enemies will be the members of his own household. I want to tell you, during the early days of the church in the second and third century, many suffered. Many thousands of believers were betrayed by their own families. Even today, we know of cultures. Now, we're studying Islamic faith and how to bring the gospel to bear with Muslims in our Sunday fellowship groups, at least in Sojourners and Joint Heirs. In some of those cultures, people, if there is a conversion, some of them actually hold funerals for the person that converted to indicate to their extended family, this person is dead to us. He is no longer part of us. Is that not what Jesus is talking about here? Again, Jesus didn't lure his followers into service making promises of how good things were going to go. He told them as it was, you will be hated by all because of my name. How hated are you because of his name? Now, you might be hated because you're not a nice person. You might be hated because you're cheap or whatever other reason. Or you cheat at golf. But are you hated because of his name? Because you are so vocal about the message that has eternal consequences for those souls that you're being hated by. It doesn't matter if they hate us. It's okay. There's something more than this life, people. These families, these relationships even, there's something that far surpasses the goodwill of those around us because it is eternal and it does not fade away. And that is spiritual, eternal life. Sixthly, they were to be courageous, verses 24 through 31. A disciple is not above his teacher, nor a slave above his master. It's enough for the disciple that he become like his teacher, and the slave like his master. If they have called the head of the house Beelzebub, how much more will they malign the members of his household? Expect it. It's coming. Those who do not fear them, therefore do not fear them. Verse 26, verse 28, do not fear those. And verse 31, so do not fear, you are more valuable than many sparrows. Three times he says, don't fear. Don't fear them, meaning those who called Jesus Beelzebub. Do not fear those who can kill the body but are unable to kill the soul. This is serious stuff. And finally, a generic sense, do not fear. Why? Because they were engaged in something far greater than the love and affection of people around them. They were witnessing. They were doing what we call evangelism. Ours is the same message. We have to question ourselves, do we really believe Jesus' words when he says, don't fear those who kill the body but are unable to kill the soul, but rather fear him who is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. Not ours, theirs. Theirs. Do you see them? Do you have compassion on them? Do you know that they're headed for a Christless eternity, for all eternity? We only get 80 years and then maybe some more if God is pleased. Here, compared to all eternity, are you kidding me? Once again, the assurance Jesus gives to faithful proclaimers of the truth is you are more valuable to God the Father. He will provide. You do have a future, and it's completely secure because it's in Christ, my son. So then, just to keep everything in mind, the call is urgent. The messengers are equipped. And though the message is costly, we're to give it away freely. We're to expect hardship as we give this message out, and not as some strange thing happening to us. expect loneliness and persecution, maybe even from our own family members, our brothers, our uncles, our parents. But we're to be courageous. And finally, the seventh point, they were to be single-minded. Single-minded. Verses 32 through 39. Therefore, everyone who confesses me before men, I will also confess him before my Father who's in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will also deny him before my Father who is in heaven. Don't think that I came to bring peace on the earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I came to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and a man's enemies will be the members of his household. He who loves father or mother more than me isn't worthy of me, Jesus said. And he who loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me, Jesus said. And he who does not take his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me, Jesus said. He who has found his life is going to lose it. And he who has lost his life for my sake will find it. I can't tell you how many people that we know, Mary and I, that began training for missions to go to the mission field, that stepped out of the training because the wife was not with them, or to protect their children because they didn't want to submit them to the kind of living conditions that they would have to submit them to, or because their parents were elderly, even though they had multitudes of siblings that could take care of mom and dad. But they turned their back on going in a calling that I think some of them were actually called to because of those reasons. I think that's exactly what God's talking to us about here. Pick up your cross and follow him. It's going to be hard. Your own family might go against you, but don't deny him. Stay true to him because you will be with him for all eternity. Why would anyone even consider this kind of radical faith? I'm up here preaching away and I'm thinking, wow, this is a hard message. This is really challenging. I mean, this is getting down to the nitty-gritty here. Why would anybody even consider such radical? Why would someone even give Jesus direction to proclaim this message when he warns of such pushback and problems? Why would anybody heed that? Well, it all goes back to the simple truth that when Jesus is speaking, and what he's speaking of in these verses is the difference between eternal life and eternal separation for people. Those people that he saw and had compassion on because they were distressed and dispirited. The message that we have is a message of eternal life. And we are completely surrounded by people who do not have that eternal life, mostly simply because they've not heard the message. More and more so every day in America. It's for that reason that Jesus exhorts believers to be single-minded in obediently fulfilling the mandate that he's given us to preach the gospel. True believers have entered into new life, a life that's not their own. And as Jesus said to his first followers, his words still apply to us today. Who does not take up his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Listen, I know it's scary to talk to people about the gospel and Jesus. But honestly, if you just took that little phrase I gave you, just that little question, it at least starts the process. And you might find it's easier than you think it is. And if you just would concentrate more on the eternality of things, the fact that you have eternal life, you rejoice in your salvation, and yet so many around us have no idea of what eternal life is. So begin to talk to them about the joy that you have and the assurance that you have in your own soul. He who has found his life will lose it. What does that mean? It means if you're so self-protective, if you're so self-protective and so fearful of other people and the blowback that you're going to get for speaking the truth out, do you really have the truth? It says here, he who has found his life, the one that pulls his life to himself and protects himself, it says here, he's going to lose it. Now, I don't believe that a believer who is a true believer can lose his salvation. I believe in the perseverance of the saints, eternal security, however you phrase that. But I'm just saying, if we're so worried about what people are going to think of us because we share with them the most important thing in our life, really? The single-mindedness Jesus calls his followers to is nothing short of complete surrender to his plans and his agenda, living for Christ, living with eternity in mind. In this way, the world is going to hear that the kingdom of heaven is at hand, and some will be saved, and we will find the true meaning and purpose of life on earth as Christ's followers. You know what? There's a lot of people that are really, truly afraid because Donald Trump is the president. Use that. Use it to your advantage to preach a gospel to them. Take it and say, I don't know, he might get us in a nuclear war. What are you going to do if you die? Just run with it. Don't try and convert him to being a Republican. Don't tell him how much you wanted Ted Cruz to win and you're not for Trump either. Leave that stuff alone. Take whatever opportunity you have to veer the conversation into spiritual things and realities. Kingdom of heaven is at hand. And as you preach that and you talk about that, some will be saved, and you might be shocked who gets saved. That's the adventure part. And find the true meaning and purpose of life on earth as Christian followers. I want to ask you one question in closing, okay? Are you in? Are you in? Only you can answer that. Your wife can't answer it for you guys. Your husbands can't answer it for you. Your parents can't answer it for you. You just need to ask yourself, am I in this thing for real? Or is this just a facade? I pray you're in it for real. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we are grateful to you for the extreme privilege that we have. Number one, to have as a current possession eternal life. Jesus teaches that those that have eternal life will not see death. We will not feel and experience the sting of death, that separation, because the bridge has been made between us and God, the reconciliation, the satisfaction has been made by Jesus Christ on our behalf. But Lord, there are multitudes around us that don't know that joy, don't know that assurance, don't have that hope. They're without God and without hope in the world. Help us, Lord, to be better at just talking to them about things that matter to us spiritually. For we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.